Hello, I'm Charles Fisher of FishDuck.com. Want to know the basics of the Oregon offense in just a few minutes? This first tutorial is meant to be a foundation covering the crucial components that make the Oregon offense special. You're going to learn more than 99% of Oregon fans and 100% of the sportscasters that cover Oregon football. I spent 12 hours one week alone studying the differences between the inside and outside zone read, and you're going to learn it in just a few minutes.
This is geared to the casual fan who wants to learn a little more about the Oregon offense and enjoy the game more. They will better know what just happened when they looked at the replay after a touchdown. I'm going to go easy on the football jargon, and while you coaches and knowledgeable fans out there will find this stuff rudimentary, this wasn't created for you, since you already know all this. This is for the casual fan. I was frustrated at times over the last 6 years with the spread offense because I found I could not figure out what was happening on the field. With the spread offense, big holes would appear, but how? How do you make the Red Sea part like that? How did that get so open for the quarterback? Plays would start in one direction, but the ball would end up somewhere else on a routine basis, and Chip was fine with it? We just had a huge hole for a great play. Now how did that happen? Why was it successful? Is there any consistency to the formations at all? We could end up anywhere, it seemed, no matter what the initial formation was. I really wanted to understand what we were doing. The sportscasters on TV have been terrible. Frequently, they say nothing because they're at a loss to explain what just happened. Kirk Herbstreit is the best of them in identifying the zone read, but not he nor anyone else as of August of 2011 have explained the difference of the basic two plays of the Oregon offense, the inside and outside zone read, which the offense revolves around. Unfortunately, he has also confused who was being zone read a number of times. If we see an explanation on TV for the first time this fall, after going into now the seventh year of running this offense, then we'll know what website they went to. How did I learn this? I put a ton of time watching games in slow motion on my TiVo, but I first studied the presentation given by Coach Kelly to a Nike coaches clinic a few years ago. I have it on my website, but I got it off the Cal and USC websites as it had been available freely for years. It shows the formations for the inside and outside zone reads as well as a ton of the basics of the offense. The truth is, much of this information about the Oregon offense is available on many football and spread offense websites for coaches and fans as well. It's not just the X's and O's, it's the man behind the offense that makes it work.
There are going to be more tutorial videos about the offense. Be sure and watch them in order. Tell your friends that without the background information, the videos after the first two will not make sense. This is Abby. She is part pit bull, but she is very sweet, unless she sees a husky.
And that's a good dog, Abby. Yes, that's a good dog.
The formation in the backfield is one of the two primary indicators that tell us whether it's an inside or outside zone read, which are the two basic plays the entire offense revolves around. You'll see why over the course of the tutorials. See how the running back is behind the quarterback? That's an inside zone read. See how the running back is to the side of the quarterback with this play? That's an outside zone read. See that? It's an inside zone read, back to the side, but behind the quarterback, while the outside zone read is nearly even with the quarterback and to the side. See that? Inside. Outside. Inside. Outside. It took me hours to figure out that difference, and then I realized that all I had to do was check Chip Kelly's presentation from the USC website, and there it was. This is the darndest thing you're ever going to see. Chip announces the play in advance. Against Stanford, they've got 8 in the box, yet even with that, we have a man-on-man blocking, or hat-on-hat as they say, and we go in for the touchdown, even though they know it's an inside zone read to our right side. When we're lined up in this formation, it's always an inside zone read. It's been that way for 6 going on 7 years, and our opponents know it. Look at this play against UCLA. We're lined up initially with an inside zone read going to the right, and they know it. And then watch what happens when Michael James shifts over to now threaten an inside zone read to the left, and what do? They shift. They know exactly where the play is, and consequently that's why they stuffed it. The inside zone read is the foundation play of the Oregon offense, as everything starts with this play. The complementary plays will not work, not the bubble screen, not the play action passes, not the triple option, if the two foundation plays of the inside and outside zone read don't work. and success with the outside zone read depends upon the threat of the inside zone read. Thus, it all starts right here with the inside zone read. Look at the path of the play. It is intended to go between the guard and the tackle, effectively an old dive play. That's not hard to defend if you're the defense. Just jam the middle of the play side. Well, now, what is the play side? It is the side of the offense that the play is going to. Inside zone read to the right, thus the play side is the right side of the offense. The back side is the opposite side the play is going to, and that makes sense. The zone read adds another element to the play, and that is the backside zone read of the defensive end. Sometimes it is the defensive tackle, but that is another video. What is zone reading a defender? Well, it's what we used to call optioning a player. When we ran the old option attacks, we would option the defensive end or tackle. Now the verbiage is zone read, meaning that whoever occupies that space or spot is being optioned or zone read. We react to what he does. It is common that we zone read the best defensive lineman or linebacker, thus we negate his effect on our offense. If he stays put, then the running back has the ball and running away from the defensive end. If he chases the running back, then the quarterback pulls the ball and runs through the slot where the defensive end was. So it doesn't matter where the defensive end goes, the ball ain't there. As a defensive coordinator, you don't want the quarterback running down the backside of your defense, yet you don't want the ball in LaMichael James' hands either. Most defensive ends will stay put to prevent the quarterback running through the hole they just vacated. When that happens, the quarterback is going to hand off to the running back, which is what Chip Kelly wants. So now we have stretched the defense out with the zone read on one side and where the running back is going to run on the other side of the line of scrimmage. There is something much more subtle and yet important that is one of the primary reasons for Oregon's success running the ball since we went to the spread offense. When you don't block the defensive end on the backside of the play, the blocking responsibilities shift over from one offensive lineman to another over to the play side. That means we pick up an extra blocker on the play side where the play is going. That is huge. If we can get everyone covered blocking, hat on hat as they call it, on the play side, then it shoots our running game through the roof, which in my mind is the principal reason we became one of the nation's leading rushing teams. We're going to talk about zone blocking in the next tutorial about the outside zone read. But notice that straight ahead blocking is what occurs on most inside zone reads. The coach says he wants this play to be a physical downhill running kind of play. We knock the crap out of the defender and deposit him in the linebacker's lap is kind of the mantra. It's physical football, and we make over 7 yards a carry on it in a typical year. And this is off of a dive play. He states that we block 5 play side defenders on each play after the defense commits to what their scheme of attacking us on that play will be. We then identify those players that we want to block through a simple system. If our guys can count to 6, Chip says, then we got a good chance of running the play. So how do you explain huge holes open up in front of Oregon running backs? Everyone says our line is too small. So how did they open that hole? After the Stanford game, the talking heads on ESPN would say, well, they're running the veer and blah, blah, blah.
Rin 1010 could see that we weren't running the veer in the Stanford game. Now, if that dates me, make it Shadow or Chance or Benji or Lassie, whatever. The point is, when you're running a veer, you're optioning or zone reading a defensive tackle and a defensive end on the same side in the same play. Were we running a veer then in the Stanford game? No!
How do you defeat this offense? The same way any other offense is defeated, and it's simple. Defeat the blocks. Because we announced the play, we have more negative plays losing yardage than anyone else. Yet that is what makes us most explosive. What? It is the overreacting by the defense to where they know the play is going. A big reason for the success of the play is because we announce it in advance. Defenses overreact to where the play is going, and it creates huge gaps elsewhere. They can't defend the entire line of scrimmage. The running backs in this offense are to check the gap we're attacking, but take a quick look around. If another hole opens up elsewhere that's better, he has the green light to go for it, and they do. In the game against Stanford, we see great overreaction by the defense to the inside zone read. We're lined up to do an inside zone read to our right. Stanford is spread out because we just beat them with a couple of bubble screens. After the snap, you see how all of them move to their left, anticipating the direction and the spot of the inside zone read. Meanwhile, a big hole opens up to the right, and LaMichael James bursts through it. In the Civil War game, we see how we're doing an inside zone read to the left, but the Beavers immediately see that, and they move over as quick as they can. that immediately opens up a hole to the right as Darren Thomas is zone raiding the defensive end, and you can see Barner with his footwork, how he starts to move to the left inside zone read and then cuts to the right in the open hole and takes off. It's a great example of the defense overreacting and opening up a hole on the other side of the line of scrimmage. The inside zone read is running a dive play on the right and a zone read on the left, and you actually accomplished three things at the same time. You pick up a play side blocker, which is a massive advantage as I've spoken of, and you often negate the best defensive line on the other team with the zone read, and you stretch the defense by making them defend the entire field, all of that from announcing an inside zone read in advance. Let's say I'm a defensive coordinator trying to stop Oregon. Just because we line up in the inside zone read formation doesn't mean we actually run an inside zone read. It might be a bubble pass instead. Or we run a speed double option the other direction of the inside zone read. Or a vertical pass downfield that begins with an inside zone read play action fake. It could be the power play that runs to the opposite side of the inside zone read and sucks the defenders the wrong direction. So a defensive coordinator has to defend the ancillary plays to the inside zone read, yet if he focuses just on them, we burn the defense with what we intended to run, the inside zone read.
Let's say I'm a defensive coordinator at another Pac-12 school, and I want to get this right. If I plug the inside zone read gap with more players, that opens up holes on the other side of the line of scrimmage. Yet if I bring other players up to defend that, then that's going to open me up to speed double options, to bubble screens, and to play action passes downfield. So even though I know where the play is going half the time, I still have to defend the entire field? Well, that sucks.
In our conference, you see UCLA running the zone read with the pistol. Washington has been running zone read plays for 2 years now. Stanford ran some zone read with Andrew Luck last fall, and Arizona State ran some zone read against us. Throw in Utah and Oregon, who've been doing the zone read for years, and you have half the Pac-12 running the zone read. The difference among the teams is simply execution of this offense.
Oh, how we love to learn about our Ducks. I'm Charles Fisher, Fish Duck. And for more videos and reports, come to fishduck.com.